biology center with many institutes, and I'm working in the Institute of Hydrobiology, specifically in a department of fish and zooplankton ecology, but I can just say the Institute of Hydrobiology because I speak a bit with all the people there. And well, there are many problems that people are working in there. And when I arrived there, it was like, okay, Carlos, so we an increase of many phytoplankton in the medium. And that may have many negative effects. First of all, that, for example, will, first of all, avoid the penetration of light into the medium, into the aquatic medium. It may also, for example, transform this region in an anoxic region, so avoiding the oxygen in the medium. But also, it may have some problems from a recreational point of view, because of course we don't want to have recreation in a water, in a body water like this.
Why?
So I started to focus in this problem. And so they have like a project of biomanipulation. And the idea of biomanipulation, but the idea is very simple. You know, we have here the phytoplankton, and phytoplankton in this medium usually is consumed by zooplankton. Okay, these guys are zooplankton, and zooplankton is consumed by fish. So what people try to do there is to fish, to remove fish from the medium, so that you are going to increase the quantity of zooplankton, and in such a way you are going to decrease the quantity of phytoplankton, and so that you are going to control the blooms. And this is usually known in ecology as a top-down control, because you are like controlling the upper, the top part of the trophic chain, and you are controlling like the lowest trophic level. Okay.
It's edible phytoplankton.
Yes, that's another problem. Because yes. Along this presentation, I'm going to guess that we're speaking about edible phytoplankton. But because, yes, biomanipulation does not always work, especially if the phytoplankton that is present in the medium is not eaten by zooplankton, okay? So, so yes, we are going to... we're focusing, if you want, in edible phytoplankton. So we'll continue. Okay, so... biomanipulation, as Olivier asked, if phytoplankton is edible, well, there are many reasons why biomanipulation could not work, okay? And one problem, for example, because people there in Czech Republic, they fish, but they say, no, that sometimes goes well, but sometimes does not go well. They have a lot of data, but they don't really treat the data. They only do like basic statistics. So, in principle, I have to try to understand something there. And for example, one problem why maybe biomanipulation doesn't work sometimes is because people usually they are going to fish to catch like the big ones, okay? And when they catch the big ones, they are going to favor the growth of the small ones, because if you want the... this is like the same fish species, okay? And, but this is like a different ages. So these are like the old ones, and these are the new ones. So if you fish only the big ones, you are going to favor the growth of the small ones, and the small ones, they grow very rapidly. So maybe they are going to have rapidly, again, a lot of fish that are going to consume the zooplankton, so they are not going to control the phytoplankton, okay? Even though biomanipulation works in the literature, there are many works that show that biomanipulation can work, but the next problem is that sometimes when biomanipulation works, the problem is that it's not stable. But I think that it's not stable because people stop removing fish, and so the ecosystem come back to the original state. Okay, so from now on, maybe I'm going to say some things that are not very accurate from a biological point of view, okay? I'm still, I think, adapting in this new subject, but I'm going to show some things that I have done until now. So in the rest of the presentation, I want to show you a fish model that we are working on, and then some theoretical results about some mathematical analysis of the models, And finally, I will come back to the title of the presentation, and I'm going to show some simulations that, well, you will see.
Just a word. It's not completely clear, but when you control the fish, you will be able to lower phytoplankton.
That's the main idea,
yes. Yes, it's the main idea, but it's not completely clear. For example, the zooplankton, phytoplankton could have oscillation, and one could imagine that if you control something, you will increase the oscillation, and maybe you will have less phytoplankton, but larger bloom of phytoplankton.
Yes, it may happen.
It's not so clear,
No, I think here is indeed a very complex system.
Okay.
And that's the idea also of using mathematics to try to understand
exactly
this kind of situations.
Yes.
To give some insight on that.
Exactly.
Okay. So I will start speaking about the fish model. As I said in the introduction, it's very important to consider the different GR classes of fish. Okay. When I speak of GR classes, that means, for example, the H0 is like the fish that were born this year. The H1 are the fish that were born the previous year, and so on, okay? And usually, depending on the fish, you may have many GR classes. For this scheme, that the only purpose of this scheme is to explain the model, I'm just going to assume that we have the 3 GR classes, okay? So, the idea of the model, so there we have the 3 GR classes, and for each GR classes, we're going to consider a variable for the population density and one variable for the weight of fish. Okay, the weight is very important in fish because depending on the weight, the fecundity of fish will vary. You know, if a fat fish maybe will produce more newborns. Okay, so it's very important to take into account the age, and also feeding will change the rate of feeding depending on the weight. So here there is probably the most important hypothesis of the model, and is that we are going to say that the fish will reproduce only once per year, okay? And this is something that happened with many fish in freshwater ecosystem, like the remote reservoir, where there are fish like bream, roach, bleak, that reproduce only once per year. And the second hypothesis is that this reproduction, usually in fish terminology, reproduction, people say spawning, okay? That's why I say spawning here, and here reproduction process, but it's the same, okay? So we are going to assume that this will happen very rapidly, okay? And it's the case. There are some fish, for example, roach, that will put the eggs, and maybe in 10 days, the newborns will be already there in the water, okay? Or maybe another fish will take 1 month, all the process of reproduction. But still, in the model, there is the logic that reproduction is happening once per year, okay? So we have here, speaking a bit more about reproduction, when we have the reproduction, so we will have like the big ones that are going to reproduce a lot. We will produce a lot of newborns, and those that are a bit smaller, you know, they are reproducing a bit less. And the second thing, so this is what is happening during the reproduction process. And each time that we have arrived to the reproduction process, we are going, each GR class, we promote to the next generation, you know? So fish that were here H0, now they are H1. And here there should be 5 fish, okay? Because they are not dying here. That is a mistake of my slide. So here there should be 5, and then 5. And the same here, you see you have 2, and it's like at school, you know? They are like changing the grade. And they are going to the next school, but fish are clever, they are all passing the next grade. So we have two, but they become, they lose weight, okay? Because they are reproducing. They are producing newborns, so they are losing weight. That's why they are small now. They are smaller. And the last one, where they are going out of school, they are dying, okay? At least fish for fish, they are dying. So we are like saying that here fish only will live, the lifespan will be only 3 years. So this is what is happening like in an instant, and that's why then we will have an impulsive system. Then, during the year, okay, we will have the evolution of the system. What will happen is that all these fish, some of them will die during the year, okay? So some fish will die from natural mortality. And this is written by a very simple equation, just mortality, okay? This is what happened with the population. For the other one, you know, three will die, and here one will die during the year. And at the same time, fish will grow in weight during the year, okay? So we have another equation for describing the evolution of weight, and the same for each year class, okay? And here we start to see that the model is a bit complicated in terms of parameters, because each year class may have a different set of parameters.
Hmm? What is Z?
Where is Z?
Z.
Ah, Z. Ah, okay. Z. Okay. That represents the zooplankton concentration.
Ah,
okay. Okay. Yes, I didn't say that. But yes, the idea is that the growth, yes, I didn't say that, but the idea is that the growth, if you want, this is like a specific growth rate of weight, depending will depend on the on zooplankton. Okay, so that is more or less the model, and then we arrive again to a spawning period, and all this process will happen again. And again, the evolution and the system will evolve like that. I will summarize the equations in one slide later. Now I just want to speak about the growth, when fish growth. So for describing the equations for growth, so here we have the growth function, we use something that is known as bioenergetics modeling approach. And it's like you are considering all the, you consider the consumption, the respiration, digestion, excretion, active metabolism, all the balances of energy here in fish to describe the growth, okay? For example, here, I'm not going to show the expression of it, so of these terms, because as I say, describing all this function G is a bit extensive, okay? But I can say that, for example, if we use what in this paper was done, I have the impression that we don't see very well the...
Oh, it's curved, it's curved.
Oh, okay. So the function G is here, and usually we will obtain something like that, okay? I think that is enough for the presentation, but if we do all the simplifications, etc., etc., we are going to obtain something like that, where we see here should be WEI. We obtain something that depends in WBI and Z, and CI correspond to the consumption, of zooplankton. So also here, when we see the function for the consumption, we see that this will be slower as the fish grow, and it will be higher as there is more zooplankton in the medium. Okay. What else can I say about that? Where the zooplankton, usually, then I'm going to show parameters about this particular fish, which is known as bleak, because this is a fish that there is a lot there in the remote reservoir. It's a small fish, there is a lot. The favorite food of this one is this cladocerum, this kind of zooplankton that is known as, well, I'm not going to pronounce the name. And here also I have to say that this is a bit complicated, because there are many parameters, and usually people, for example, measure fish with certain units, then the zooplankton in certain units, mm-hmm. and then when you want to pass from one unit to the other, you have to do a lot, to find in the literature a lot of conversion factors. So there are many things that also from that point of view are a bit complicated. What else to say? Also in fish, and this is probably the first question that people are also, they are asking me is, and aren't you considering the temperature for fish? Because apparently it's very important, the temperature. So yes, I put the temperature here in the consumption. So depending on the temperature, fish will consume more or less zooplankton, okay? And also here, there are some parameters that may depend on the temperature, okay? But I'm not going to put all the details.
But concerning bioenergetics, I remember that a long time ago, we read a book by Koishman. Is it also, do you know this name, Koishman? He has done modeling and bioenergetics, he called that.
Maybe, I must say that I read many papers about that, yes, so yes. I don't really remember the names, but maybe.
Because it had also this name of bioenergetics, I think.
Yes, but probably it's the same approach where you consider all the energy balances and the energy budgets in the organism.
Yes.
But yes,
energy budget. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, as I said here, there are many parameters. Okay, many parameters. So, and especially for this fish, that this is one of the fish we're interested in, the bleak. It's a bit difficult to find the parameters. Maybe because it's not from a commercial point of view, it's not a very important fish. So we try to estimate some parameters, but this is. I'm not completely sure at which extent this is a legal procedure, okay? But I haven't showed any model of zooplankton, okay? So at this moment, I'm just going to use, we have zooplankton data, okay? There are different sizes of zooplankton, and here I'm using like the big zooplankton, because are like the favorite food of bleak. And we have the data of zooplankton. And it could be difficult, okay, doing a model for describing the evolution of zooplankton is difficult, okay? There are many things happening in the lake. So for starting and for having an idea of what are the parameters of the model of bleak, so what I did is just to say, okay, I'm going to use the data of zooplankton as an input into the model of fish, of the fish weight, okay? So what I do here is just to use like a smooth spline here for reconstructing all the data. Okay. I put it into the model of fish, and I try to calibrate the model. And here in the surplus, this is the data that they have. Well, in reality, once per year they go there. They are going to fish a lot, okay? And then they will have like count all the fish, and they are going to have distributions of weight. And from this data, they will have like the average weight of each GR class. Okay, so for example, here you see they are the average weight of the first GR class of the H1, the data, the average weight of H2, the average weight of okay.
The fish.
How do they know the age of?
They do estimations from the weight, and also they study the scales of fish. For example, when they go to remove fish, they will keep some scales, and from the scales you can determine the age. And also they take like a part of the body that is called the otolith. That I don't understand very well, but also there is like a small bone that that is used for determining the age. But it's mainly based on the size of fish and the distribution.
And they are not fished, these fish?
Yes, they are caught. They are removed.
But apart from when they are counted, in your model you take into account the fact that they are fishermen?
Okay. At this moment I'm just using the weight model. And there it's not very important how much they are removing. But if I move to the population density model, there it's very important. And that is exactly what I'm going to say then, that's a problem, that for them, they at this moment, they haven't gave me some estimations of how much they are removing. And I did need this data for doing, for example, a calibration with the population data set. But if we put zooplankton, the effects of removing fish, at some extent, is affecting the zooplankton population. But here, I'm just putting the zooplankton as a input variable. So there is a feedback that will not be here. So for estimating the parameters of weight, it's not very important the fishing, the how much they are removed. But for the population density, yes. Okay. Okay. What else? So okay. So for this model, I just tried to estimate 5 parameters, even though there are many parameters, because. For example, if we take, well, here we have the respiration rate. If we go to the respiration rate, we with this term here, this parameter ARI, we are going to have 4 different parameters, one for each GR class. So I'm not going to estimate each one, you know, but I went to the literature and I find, for example, these parameter values for another species. And I try to keep like the proportions. I think it's not so stupid to do that, because I guess maybe in other fish species, the proportions as they grow, maybe they can be similar, okay? And this is like a first approximation that I'm doing, because I don't want to estimate four parameters. So I go, I take the parameters of other fish, and I take a, and I multiply by a constant. So I estimate only k and not each AR. And it's the same for the other parameters, okay? Okay, and I did that with fmin search, and the rest is a classic step in fitting a model, okay? Then just some comments about the population. These are, okay, estimating the population, the fish population, that is, I think, a very big problem. And I think people don't do it well. But here we have some data of bleak, and we see more or less how the population evolved during the last year. Here, well, not so many bleak, but suddenly they exploded. And we observe, for example, something that happened. We can also find in other works that here there is like a alternating, you know, a big success of bleak, no success, a lot of succeed, and etc. And this is something that we are going to see also with the model. So there are also so many parameters associated to the population model, but I haven't estimated these parameters, and it's exactly the reason is that what Olivier was saying. I don't really have an estimation of how much we remove per year. And this estimation, how much they're removing per year, should be put into the model. So for now, to estimate the parameters associated to the population model, well, we are not really estimating these parameters, but we put some parameters that will give reasonable values. Okay, we know more or less which is the order of the population density, so we try to stay in this order, and that's all what we can say, we can do until now. Unfortunately,
but if you had fishing data, fishing effort, something like that, you could estimate maybe the
how much they are fishing.
How much? No.
Yes, in principle they told me that they are going to provide me some estimations, but I'm sure they are not going to be very well, because they don't really know how which is the real fraction that they are fishing, because also the fish they are clever, they are moving, sometimes they go to fish and the fish will hide. They are not stupid, the fish, they evolve, they learn. So, okay, so... Okay, so now I'm just going to tell you how, because I want to study a bit the model. And I'm going to summarize now the model, but before I just want to tell you how do we fish. Not how do we fish in the lake, but how do we fish in the model. Okay, because I don't go to fish. I went once, but it was only to see if I could find something to eat, some fish. Okay, so the idea is that well, there are different strategies for fishing. Here I'm going to present you one that is like you're going to fish exactly before spawning, okay? Because you, in that such a way, you are going to avoid too much spawning. So you will start, here is the time of spawning, of reproduction. You will start with these 2 year classes. So you're going to take some of them, for example, half of them. And so then you're going to have this quantity of fish. Then for the other one, you're going to take also a fraction, and you're going to have this quantity of fish, okay? So, and well, and then they're going to reproduce this, and the newborns that are represented by all of these, by all these guys, will be given by something like this, you know? So here you take into account all what is produced by these guys, and all what is produced by these guys, and in this term, we are going to see how much did we fish. This is where this will be affecting. Okay, and now just to summarize all the model. Okay, so usually we are going to give an initial weight to the newborns. This is also what I say, that each time that we arrive to the reproduction moment, fish will lose some weight because of reproduction. Okay, it's like 20%, 25%, 10%, it depends on the fish. Then we are going to have an expression for the newborns, is what I was explaining here. Each year class will give us some newborns, so we are accounting for all the newborns, so the newborns of each year class. And finally, we are promoting a fish like going to the next grade in school, okay? And then the dynamics of the population, we have here a mortality rate, and we have the evolution of wealth. So this is the model I was speaking about, that was it was a bit hidden. Okay, and that's the model. And now, okay, what can I say now? Well, let's see the next slide. Okay, so what I do now that we have now a model, I have some parameters that I estimated, as I say. And now, well, this is the part of the fish. Now I want to couple the model with the zooplankton model. But as I said, I haven't really worked in the zooplankton dynamics, but for doing some mathematics, I like going to use the most simplest zooplankton model. This is very simple. As I say, just we are going to have a grounding capacity, and here we are going to have all the pressure done by fish. Okay, so we are considering the consumption of each GR class of zooplankton, and here we have the growth of zooplankton. Okay.
The objective of your model was not to control phytoplankton in the beginning.
Ah yes. Okay, I am back. So because I like. Now I like splitting into two directions. There is one where I want to do some mathematics, and in that direction I like considering only zooplankton and to see how the fish will act on zooplankton. And because there I can do some mathematics. Okay, I can study, for example, the survival of fish, the fish population, the conditions for the eradication of fish. But then I'm going to put also phytoplankton, but there is mainly numerical simulations. Okay. And it's another word to mimic the phytoplankton blooms. But yes, I like splitting because I want to do some theory also, you know. I don't want to stay doing only the simulations. So this is the second part of the presentation. And what I want to do now is to determine conditions for the survival and extinction of the fish population. In some cases, for the success of biomanipulation, it's even necessary to eradicate all the fish. But also that may have some applications, for example, when you have an invasive species that may affect negatively the biodiversity, so you want to eradicate an invasive species. So now it's more mathematics representation. So, and this is something that they like to do. Let's imagine that there are no fish in the medium, okay? If there are no fish, so this is a very simple equation for zooplankton. And we know that Z will converge to KZ, okay? So it's like to say that the maximal concentration of zooplankton in the medium will be KZ, okay? So if I put KZ into the equations for the weight, okay? This equation will give me like the highest weight that fish can reach, okay? Because I'm putting the maximal concentration that fish can reach. What I say here, okay? And in this simple equation, we can prove that each solution will go to a periodic solution of 1 year, okay? And when we have this, this is something, okay? So this is a simulation, okay? This is this system with KZ, but Z, not Z, KZ. And we see that WE, okay, WE has four components, okay, for each year class. I'm assuming that there are only 4 year classes. So we see that each component will evolve to a one periodic solution. And this is like the highest way that fish can reach in the system, okay? So when we have this highest weight, we can find like the maximal fecundity that fish will have in the medium. Okay, the fecundity is defined like that, and this means how many newborns they are going to produce per fish, okay, per individual. So from this slide, we only have to remember bar beta I that represents the maximal fecundity. So now, for determining if my fish population will survive or not, we have to contrast. Well, we don't have to do it, but I do it. We construct these matrices, okay? We have one matrix A, we are going to put all the mortality rates, okay, in the diagonal. All the mortality rates, usually for the newborns, mortality rate is very high. while for the old fish, mortality rate is much slower. And then we're going to construct the second matrix, if you want, and I call it the reproduction matrix. And it's here where we have the fishing before spawning, and we have all the maximal reproductions, okay, that were determined according to what I did in the previous slide. And what we can prove is that, well, we have to study this matrix. We construct now this matrix from these ones. So here we have the logarithm of a matrix. Here we have the exponential of a matrix, where we have all these. And so we have to study the eigenvalues of this matrix. And if all the eigenvalues are negative, well, they have a negative real part. So each solution of the model will go to zero. So that will give us the eradication of fish. However, if there is at least one eigenvalue with a positive real part, we will have a kind of weak persistence. But if you want, we are just saying that the solution without the fish will not be stable. Okay, will repair solutions. Okay, so well, and the proof of this is basically to give some arguments and at the end to compare with this linear system, okay, to compare all the model that I showed before for the population, to compare it with this linear system, okay. But I will
Is there, why do you go to the logarithm? Why don't you say directly the eigenvalue of b plus I exponential a has have to be inside the unit circle?
Well, I don't know, it was the first way
matrix or something
you see what happened. Okay, yes, I must say that I didn't thought very much about this part. I just went to this equation. I saw, okay, we need this. But
just above there you have a discrete system somewhere.
Yes.
I have a what?
The discrete system. You can compute directly the probability of this matrix.
But it's not false, I just. Another way of presenting things.
Well, indeed, then I do another presentation of this, because indeed you can obtain the. You can calculate the characteristic polynomial of this. Mm-hmm. It's not. The matrices are not very ugly, so they allow to determine the. the characteristic polynomial, and yes, and there in my results I didn't put it here, but yes, in such a case, so I say if the roots of the polynomial are like in the unit cycle, so you have the eradication. Mm-hmm. So maybe that looks a bit closer to what you say.
Okay.
Because yes. Okay. So yes, you can calculate the characteristic polynomial of the previous matrix, and you can. And then you can determine the conditions. For example, well, what I did here then, it was that I, only for doing theoretical things, huh? I assume now that my fish, they can live only during 2 years, for example. 2 years, and in such a case, all these ugly things you can be reduced to this, okay? So we obtain this relationship to say, if the population will survive or not, okay?
Sorry, you know more or less how many years do they live? Do you know if
in reality, the fish were bleak. The fish that for which I estimated the parameter is more or less 4 years, most of them, and that is also why we choose that fish for estimating the parameters, because they have a short lifespan. But there are other fish that can live 20 years. Or even more. So. But yes, this is just a toy. Okay, we say, okay, they live 2 years. We obtain these conditions. So here we have the fractions that are removed. Here, just I'm playing now. Okay. So for example, if you have a fish living during 2 years, and you assume that the fish, the youngest one, do not reproduce, but the old one reproduce. So the extinction region is something like that, meaning that and here is interesting the fact that this says, okay, maybe you can fish only the young ones at 95% and you will succeed eradication of fish, or you can fish the big ones 95% or a combination of them. okay? But if now the small ones can also reproduce, so you see that if you fish only the big ones and the small ones you do not fish, it's impossible to go to eradication. Meaning that there is a threshold that you have to fish some of the small ones to reaching the extinction of fish. Okay. Maybe this is for people working in fisheries. Maybe things like that are normal, but I think it's important to formalize the just mathematics. Okay, maybe this slide I'm going to skip it because it's too much. But it was only about the study, the ultimately bonded, if solutions are ultimately bonded. Because it's also interesting, and you're right to some nice properties of the model, but I'm going to skip it. I think I'm speaking too much. just to finish now with fish model, phytoplankton, zooplankton model. Okay, so this is the last part. So now I continue with the similar model for the no, okay. I'm speaking anything. Okay, so now I have one equation for phytoplankton and one equation for zooplankton. Okay, this is also like the simplest model, at least I think the simplest model that is able to mimic the phytoplankton blooms. Okay, phytoplankton blooms in freshwater ecosystem usually happens once or two times per year. So when we consider this very simple zooplankton phytoplankton model, let's imagine that we don't have a fish here, and if we do a simulation, so we're going to take things like that. Okay, so we will see that each year we are going to have like the bloom of phytoplankton, and well, this is zooplankton. But the idea of this model is like the simplest one that is able to, I think, maybe there is another one that is even simpler, probably yes. But at least this is like a classical model of phytoplankton, zooplankton. And just by adding here some seasonality, okay, so saying that, okay, phytoplankton, there will be the effect of the temperature. So we can obtain this like yearly blooms. Well, and here there is the fish consuming zooplankton. And so now I will do, in this part, I'm just going to do some simulations because the model, maybe we can do some theory that that could be later if we estimate that it's important. So what the simulation shows. So now I'm using bleak, the parameters that I estimated. And here now finally we see a whole story, okay? So here we have the weight of bleak. Here we have the fish population of each year class. If you see the colors of each year class are the same of the in the design, okay? So these are the blue, are the small one. So we see that the populations are usually higher, and the black are the big one. Okay, what I do here is that I'm fishing each year before spawning the 10% of the biggest fish. The 10% in terms of biomass, okay? So you are going to calculate the total biomass and you are going to fish. And this is also something that usually you read in the papers of biomanipulation, that people say, oh, okay, you have to fish 75%. But this, I think it's a bit ambiguous, because sometimes they do not even say if they are speaking of biomass or population. And secondly, they don't say, as I showed before, it's very important to know if we are fishing like a small fish, big fish. And this is also something that is never said. So I think it's important to formalize all this kind of stuff. And with the mathematical model, it helps to formalize things, I think. So in this simulation, I'm fishing like the 10% of small fish, the smallest fish. And we see that this has no a big effect in terms of phytoplankton blooms, because we still see the bloom each year, okay? Then what I'm going to do is that I'm going to increase the pressure, okay? Now I'm going to fish the 50% of biomass, but I'm going to consider the biggest fish. So what we see now is that the phytoplankton blooms, they will alternate in journey. There will be 1 year with a phytoplankton bloom and a second year without phytoplankton bloom. And at the same time, we see, for example, here, this is the total biomass of fish. We see that the total biomass of fish is also alternating, okay? And this is, so maybe, this story of phytoplankton offers also an explanation of something that have been observed by people, that the fish sometimes they reach like these alternating peaks you know, a lot of fish, low quantity of fish, a lot of fish, blah, blah, blah. And this is maybe also so that what we saw here in the data of the remote reservoir. At some moment, apparently, we arrived to a stable moment where there was like this 2 years cycle. Okay. What else? Also, another thing, as I said before, when we say we fish 50%, it's important to know which 50%. If we fish the small fish, so boom, we have a complete success, eliminated the phytoplankton blooms. But again, according to the hypothesis that this that we hear, we have the edible phytoplankton. And just the last one, here we fished 75%, you know, in this window. And of course, if we stop fishing, at some moment fish will come back. And this is related to the stability of biomanipulation. Here, there is succeed.
La couleur cyan qui est là-bas, qu'on ne voit pas très bien, ça représente la population totale des...
Here, ici.
Ouais.
Yes, it's the total population.
D'accord.
Okay, yes. Just a last comment about the phytoplankton zooplankton model. That is also funny that model also, maybe all this kind of behavior is very important. I think it's very related to what is happening in the zooplankton phytoplankton model. If here I removed fish, okay, now there are no fish in the model. It's only the BZ model. And I did like a kind of bifurcation diagram with respect to the mortality rate of a zooplankton. Here it's nice to see that depending on the mortality rate, for example, if the mortality rate is low, so we have solutions with a period of 1 year, but as we increase the mortality rate, we may find another things. For example, here we have a solution with a period of 1 year, the blue one, but another solution with a period of 2 years. So maybe the periodic solution that we saw before, all that becomes from the dynamics of phytoplankton, zooplankton, and we can even find solutions of with a period of 4 years, oh well, under with 1 year. And that's all. Thank you. Well, there are some conclusions. That is more or less all what I said.
Merci. Just a small question. In your zooplankton phytoplankton model, you have also the environment, big T, capital T.
Yes,
what are you choosing for that? FP of big capital T, what are you choosing for your simulation?
I'm choosing the model of Olivier. The model for the temperature, you know, that is like that, yes.
Temperature T.
Yeah. Yeah, yes, the model for temperature,
and
yes.
It is also periodical?
Well, yes, the function will become periodic because the temperature, yes, I didn't put the function of temperature, but I think it was like a cosine.
But do you think it's important in your, for your results concerning periodic solution?
Because
model, if you suppress the periodic input, could have periodic cycles.
Yes, the problem of those periodic cycles is that they do not respect 1 year.
Okay.
There you can have yes, because here we have like the periodic cycles associated to the periodic forcing.
Okay.
But yes, if we remove the periodic forcing, we are going to have yes periodic solutions associated to the natural interaction predator prey
inside the cycle.
Yes, and there we are going to have I don't know a cycle, a phytoplankton bloom of 1,000 years.
So in your results, you always use a one.